Good morning, and welcome everyone. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It's good to be with you this morning. Today we are saying goodbye this afternoon to Doug and Shelley. They are as a reception this afternoon at 2 o'clock in the fellowship hall. Hope you can all make that. It seems weird to have Doug. He's here, you know. He's sitting right down here, if you can see. We look forward to sharing that with you today. And then next week, you get to say hello to Pastor Lori and Mark. And that will be at Stony Point next week at 11 o'clock. So be sure to make note of that, to remember to go over to Stony Point and have a time of worship together, all together. And then welcoming Pastor Lori and her husband Mark as they begin their time in ministry here with you. Other announcements you see in the bulletin, please take note of the announcement about Camp Noah and the VBS Camp Restoration, other opportunities that are listed there as well. Also, please make sure, if you haven't done so yet, there's that card in your bulletin that has to do with preparing for Pastor Lori. Put your photo on the front and then a chance to write down some favorite things in Sonoma County that you would like to recommend to them. If you haven't done that yet, please do so and get those in. It's always a privilege whenever we have the chance to worship together, and we don't take that privilege lightly or for granted. And so in the spirit of openness to what God is doing among us in our lives today, I invite you to stand if you're able and to turn to number 384 or watch it on the screens, and let's sing together our opening hymn. Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks and praise for the opportunity that we have to gather this morning and to worship you in spirit and in truth. We open our hearts, we open our lives to you. Speak to us, Communicate to us. Show us your will and your way. Our hearts, our minds, our lives are open. And we respond to your grace today. We respond to your love with our loving worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. This piece that Chuck and I will be singing today is entitled The Prayer, and a great deal of it is in Italian, so I would like to read a little translation for you. I pray you'll be our eyes and watch us where we go, and help us to be wise in times when we don't know. Let this be our prayer when we lose our way. Lead us to a place, guide us with your grace to a place where we'll be safe. I pray we'll find your light and hold it in our hearts when stars go out each night. Let this be our prayer when shadows fill our day. Lead us to a place, guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be safe. We dream of a world with no more violence, a world of justice and hope. Grasp your neighbor's hand as a symbol of peace and brotherhood. We ask that life be kind and watch us from above. We hope each soul will find grace and peace with you. Let this be our prayer, just like every child needs to find a place. Guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be safe. And the faith you've lit inside us will save us.
Oh, It's really great to see all you folks. Well, today I'll be reading out of Romans chapter 12, 9 through 18. The marks of a true Christian. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is ignoble, the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
Open my eyes that I may see. Would you rise, please?
Thank you. maybe? There we go. So some of you may know about me that my commitment to studying esoteric and sometimes useless things is, well, it's pretty high. It's a real commitment. So before I studied dead languages in grad school, I was committed to studying less useful languages in undergrad. I studied Russian language in particular, and now, of course, Russia's a thing again. But I want to let you know that I studied Russian in the early 2000s when they were just, you know, we were kind of friends with them for that really short amount of time. That's when I really invested in studying Russian. And in studying Russian, I ended up connecting with this this Russian gentleman who was interested in studying English. And so he and I would get together to work together. And he was sort of barking up the wrong tree with me because he regularly would try to turn the conversation to how you could say words of affection and love in English. It didn't go well for him, really. And one of the reasons actually is a problem with the English language. So he wanted to spend an entire lesson talking about the word love. And he could not believe me when I said there was just one word. So you mean to tell me I feel the same way about my mother as I do about a ham sandwich? Sandwiches are better in America, Grigori. It is no wonder, actually, that as English speakers, we sometimes have a failure of understanding the purview of love. We only have one word for it, and it's a little difficult to define. It is no wonder that love is often elusive. Let love be genuine, Paul writes. Let love be genuine. I wanted to throw a cat picture in there because it's Blake's last Sunday. Let love be genuine. And if you just took those words alone, it could be this sweet little meme of a cat with a kitten. Let love be genuine. Isn't love sort of that wishy-washy, slightly warm feeling that you have in your heart from time to time? Let love be genuine, Paul writes. And perhaps he thought the Romans were inclined to being overly sentimental too, because he follows it up with, let love be genuine, hate what is evil. Hate what is evil. You can go to the next slide. Hate what is evil. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. It is as if before we even begin to unpack what it means to love, we must first understand that love will require drawing a line in the sand sometimes. That love, in fact, is not always about being nice or about being kind, but that sometimes love requires us to speak a truth that is unpleasant. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Do not be afraid to speak the truth in love. Because truth and love in our present day require a good witness. Let love be genuine. And hate what is evil and hold fast to what is good. For me, in order for the church to be true about love, in order for the church to be genuine, sometimes we must wade into the things that are less pleasant to talk about. So when Paul discusses this genuine love, he feels that he must also spell out for us what love will look like acted out. And Paul names in particular three groups of people with whom we must be in relationship if we are going to genuinely love in this world. Paul writes in order for love to be genuine, we must tend to the needs of the saints and show hospitality for strangers. We must tend to the needs of the saints and show hospitality to strangers. We don't always show hospitality to strangers, do we? I've been thinking in these past few weeks that perhaps the strangers are just the saints we do not yet know. What are we doing to saints and to the children of saints, saints among us? If love is going to be genuine, it must be for each one, however long we have known them or they have been here. Let love be genuine. We must, in fact, hate evil when it is in front of us and hold fast to the possibility that good can still yet be done in a time and a place where evil seems to have the last word. Let love be genuine. Tend to the needs of the saints and show hospitality to strangers. This past week, we were at annual conference, and Bishop Carcano spoke to us a great deal. She spoke to us a great deal, full stop, period. And honestly, Bishop Carcano has a lot she can talk about. She's the kind of speaker that if she gets up and says, I'm going to read to you the phone book, you think, wow, I've never heard seven said that way. This is amazing. And she spoke to us about a number of things, and she spoke to us about immigration, about the crisis at our border. And she also spoke to us, not just on her own, but through the speakers she invited, about the need for the church to manifest itself in the world. That is, we are not here as a church to be inside of the church, but rather we are to be the church in the community, in mission, and in service to the world. When Paul writes to tend for the needs of the saints and to show hospitality to strangers, Paul is assuming that the saints are the people inside the church and the strangers are outside of the church, and yet Paul does not make that two separate sentences. He sort of runs it all together because Paul knows, like the bishop knows, that in order to fully be a community of faith, to best embody the body of Christ, to best live for this community, we must first and foremost always be in service to the people who are outside of our church walls. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good, tend to the needs of the saints, and show hospitality to strangers. And there's a third group of people who Paul talks about, and he encourages us to associate with the lonely. Associate with the lowly. It's an interesting word, associate. Associate with the lowly. Don't just serve them. Don't just give them money. Don't just pass them on the street. Don't just advocate for them at City Hall. You should probably do all those things, but also associate with them. Be close to them. Get to know them. If you wonder why the Tuesday night dinner we have together gets so much airtime in the church, it's because it's one of the ministries where you sit at a table with someone and you really get to know who they are after a while. Pope Francis writes, "The priests should smell of the street as the shepherd smells of the sheep." It's a guy who takes public transit sometimes, so I'm inclined to trust him. Associate with the lowly and do not claim to be wiser than you are. Assume that the lowly actually have something to teach you by proximity. That is the kind of genuine love that requires vulnerability. Go to the next slide. That is the kind of genuine love that requires vulnerability. One of the other things that came up for me at annual conference was there was actually a presentation from our district superintendent about what had happened in our district in this past year. And pictures of all of you were up on a big screen in Modesto for a time. You didn't know your celebrity status. You have been humble about it. But there we were looking at pictures of our fellowship hall as an evacuation center for that week or so back in October. You know, it was like 9 or 10 years ago now, right? October. And I lift that up again because a couple of weeks ago, when Pastor Blake was preaching, he spoke to that time as the church just being who we are, the church just being who you are. Once somebody asked me what our church was best at, and I said, well, this church is best at showing up. Never underestimate the importance of that. Lots of people have brilliant ideas and could do amazing things, but they never actually arrive. This church is best at showing up, and we were at our best in that time of crisis and calamity. Talk about hospitality to strangers. Talk about associating with the lowly. Talk about a glimpse at the commonwealth of God made manifest right here. Pastor Blake lifted that up as you at your best. I also want to lift that up, I think, lift up the entire Busick family as that being them at their best as well. It's one thing to show hospitality and care to other people when you are comfortable and secure with what's going on in your own life. It's another thing to show up when you're completely vulnerable. It's another thing to show up when you are in the midst of personal crisis yourselves. Beloved, if there is anything that you learn from that time or from your pastor, learn that in times of crisis and trial, at exactly the moment when you may be inclined to turn inward and turn away, if love is genuine, it will pull you into community and inspire you to be open and honest with other people. Let love be genuine, even when it is scary and difficult. Let love be genuine, even when it changes us or leaves us feeling a bit exposed. Let love be genuine. And let love be the guiding force that continues to change and shape us as a church that exists to serve in the world. We are about to go into a new chapter of our church's life together. As someone who always strives to be a good student, I'd say when you go to the next chapter, don't forget the highlights of the one you just finished. Don't forget, that was an English teacher, perhaps. Thank you. I do really try to advocate within here for myself to the teacher's lobby. I found that works well for me. Don't forget what we learned from the last chapter, which is that in the end, if love is to be genuine, love will look like us just showing up as who we are, but showing up and associating with anyone and everyone who is in need, and also risking the possibility of naming that we also are in need, that we also have not yet arrived, that we are as in need of the love of the other as they are of us. Let love be genuine. Let us allow the love of Christ to continue to work through and on us. Allow us to be the community that embodies the vulnerability of the life of Christ Jesus and manifests God's love in new ways in the world. Let us continue to testify to the genuine love that we have received and to be the body of Christ for all in our church and all we have yet to meet. Amen.
Time of prayer, we'll intercede for our brothers and sisters for their needs this morning. So let us join our hearts as we come to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful as we come together as your people to worship you this morning. We also thank you for your word, reminding us to love one another. And we believe that the first commandment that you have given to us is to love our God and to love our brothers and sisters as you have loved us. And as a way of loving our brothers and sisters, we uphold them in our prayers this morning. Wherever they are, who they are, we think of them in our prayers. We pray for those who are sick, whether they are in the hospital or at home. We pray, dear Lord, for their good health to be upon them. We also pray for those who are hungry and thirsty, that through your people their needs may be met. Those who are suffering, we also think of them in our prayers this morning, suffering physically, mentally, emotionally. And we believe, Lord, your presence may give them hope. Father, we pray for our nation today that we may grow in compassion towards our neighbor. So may we can welcome all the people, especially the immigrants among us. We also pray for those who will be leaving us. The Busick family, we thank you for their lives and the service they have rendered for the past few years. As they go to their new appointment, our prayers will go with them and bless them in this new appointment. We also pray for Shirley and Doug Albertson. So many years they have been given their lives to serve you in this church. They'll be leaving us. We pray for them. The new place they go to, we think of them. Maybe our prayers and blessing will go with them. Father, we also pray for our own needs. We give it to you, Lord, this morning in faith that you will meet our own individual needs. And we thank you that you are God who answers prayer, a God who meets our needs. This is our prayer we offer to you. In and through the name of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
And so, Lord, we also thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the ways in which you have expressed and demonstrated your genuine love for us through his life and death and resurrection. And we pledge ourselves to be instruments of his love to this world. We pray in his name and as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's sing again.
I'd like to sing a piece written by Leonard Bernstein entitled, I Go On.
And the dreams we've clung to, dying to
go on to say, I will celebrate another day. I go on. If tomorrow tumbles and everything I love is gone, I will face regret all my days, and yet I will still.
Thank you for that, Denise. The best news of all is that as we go on, God is with us, and we count on that. Praise be to God. We have had a chance to say goodbye all month, and I appreciate that from the bottom of our hearts, the many chances we have had this month to express affection and goodbyes, and I thank you for all that you have done. We're gonna miss you. And this afternoon, we have a chance to say goodbye to Doug and to Shelley at the reception. I hope that you'll be able to make that at 2 o'clock this afternoon. At the annual conference, of course, this last week, we had the reading of the appointments, as we do every year. And during that, I'm looking at Peggy. I shouldn't do that. Wait a minute. I was fine a minute ago. And of course, one of the things I want to express was that, you know, as United Methodists, we are, as clergy, we're part of a covenant together, and we're not members of the local church, we're members of the annual conference. And so we are available, and we make ourselves available to help to serve the churches in our conference, and then we're appointed to or assigned to serve those churches, and it's really a gift to be able to do that. And I just want to say how much of a privilege it's been to be one of your pastors here. And it's been also a great privilege to share the pastoral responsibilities to word and sacrament and order for 5 years with Pastor Lindsay. No better partner could I have had in this ministry than Pastor Lindsay. And then the last couple of years with Pastor Sokove, you're in great hands with both of them as we go on. At the 11 o'clock service at Stony Point, there's a stole that I'm going to leave at the altar there. And when you gather together next week, that stole will be put on Pastor Lori. And it's a great privilege to really continue and to pass on my own responsibilities here to her. I'm excited for you. I'm going to miss you, but I'm excited for you about what lies ahead with Pastor Lori, with Pastor Lindsay, with Pastor Covey, with all of you and your leadership. I'm really thrilled to what can be. And so just thank you. And look forward to celebrating with you Doug's ministry here and sending Doug and Shelley off this afternoon. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Thanks be to God. Amen.